for being here in KINS 201. And we're here with Billa, who's going to teach Dennis, or Reeser, and me, Bruce, how to do permaculture and to build our soil and how to start our organic gardens. Thank you. And Billa, thank you for coming all the way from Australia. So why don't you tell us a little about who you are, your background, and what you do in the world?
Well, thanks, Bruce. I'm really happy to be here with Dennis and yourself and see what you've got going here. It's really cool. And so, yeah, I'm from Australia, and I've been involved with permaculture and regeneration for most of my adult life, really, and been working on permaculture projects and gardening projects, social ecology, farmers markets, organic stores, that kind of thing, for a really long time. And for me, it all comes down to, I'm really passionate about helping people build soil, and especially to make compost. So that's what I'm really passionate for. And you guys here in the sandy desert, you haven't got a lot of organic material in your dirt, which you want to turn into soil. So I want to share a little bit with you about what the difference is between dirt and soil and humus. So what we're going for is to be expert humus makers, and the more people on the planet that do that, the better off we'll all be, because it's actually humus that grows plants, not people. So when we learn how to make humus, which is living soil, they grow the plants, and as long as you plant according to your climate, you can't go wrong. So a lot of people miss that step out and try and just plant trees straight in the ground and then rely on water to try and keep plants alive, and it's not enough. So especially here, you're very water dependent, and basically, yeah, you want to create the nutrition and the environment underneath the soil to support the plant, and you won't need to do anywhere near as much watering.
So now, when I grew up, I put mulch around plants, and if you see over there, I try to bring some mulch from the gardeners and in Las Vegas out here. And I bring, every time I come out here, I bring a bag and I throw it around the trees. I'm really not sure what I'm doing, except that I remember that mulch keeps the water in. It keeps the soil cool in the wintertime, hot in the summer, in the wintertime, and it breaks down and becomes soil.
Yeah.
So teach us a little bit about, where to go from here.
Yeah. Okay. Well, basically, you're looking at, when you see bare soil, you're looking at Mother Earth without her skin. So to me, I always look and go, okay, that needs to be covered up somehow, because the soil is oxidizing. So just like if you cut an apple open and leave it on the bench and it's exposed to air, soil does not like to be exposed to light. It can't actually do its thing. And all the microorganisms that like to live in soil, they don't like light either. So if you see a bare patch of soil, you know that you've got to do something about that straight away. So mulch is your first stop for that. So that's great what you've got going on over there. So any materials that you can get in, the first thing is to start seeing what you can get locally. And in mass for you guys, I mean, this is 2.5 acres here, or 5 acres. So you can start bringing in, call up the local transport department when they mulch, when they cut trees down and chip them, and have them just dump their loads out here.
Sawdust,
wood chip. Even the cuttings from the trees.
Oh, really?
Yeah, anything, any organic matter, bring it into this farm. And then with your composting, you can become really good at processing that. Or if it's wood chip, or probably not sawdust, I wouldn't put sawdust on the ground here, but wood chip would be fine. Just get it around the trees, because it will start degrading straight away and it will begin some kind of compost process.
What if you had like palm fronds or larger branches? You have to chop those up first before you put them down?
Yeah, you've got a big pile over there, so we talked about getting a chipper in for a couple of days.
Right.
Like renting one and chipping all that up and then having it there as a stockpile.
Because it doesn't do as good if it's a large piece.
No.
It's got to be chopped
down. It will dry out before it has a chance to break down.
Oh, okay.
When stuff's fresh, that's when you want to chip it, when it's really fresh. And get it while it's still got moisture in it, because that will help your soil, you see?
Right.
Otherwise, it's like, if you leave food scraps out in the desert sun, it just basically evaporates. That nutrient ends up in the sky in you know, in an airy form instead of going back into the earth in an earth form. Does that make sense? It just evaporates.
But it wouldn't if it were chopped up enough.
Chopped up and spread thick enough that it can actually hold and start to break down, moisture, see?
Okay.
And then you can water it and help it to break down more. And then you start to build a little ecosystem underneath the trees.
Now, what about, you know, one of the things we have a lot of around here is horse manure.
Mm-hmm.
Because we support the horse rescue people here. And they have, like, you know, a lot of horse manure. And a little bit of cow manure because we have the free-range cows going around here.
Mm-hmm.
How do we utilize that raw material?
That's awesome. It's awesome to have that resource. So you get as much as it, much of it as you can in here and as fresh as you can. So take the dry stuff if it's available, but if you can get fresh manure when it's still wet. I mean, the problem out here is the horses are eating really dry grass anyway, so they're not, you know, the manure is quite dry, I've noticed already, you see. Whereas if on a horse on a really lush green paddock is going to have poop that's like that, you see. So get as much manure as you can. Stockpile it in big piles in the shade if possible. And then with your dry materials that we were just talking about that you've got all chipped up, that's the basis for your compost making.
Okay, now you showed me the compost in Sedona at the garden that you're working in there. How do we start building these compost piles, and how many of them do we build, and what's the process on building the compost, which I guess is the precursor to building the soil?
Sure, yeah. Well, you want to build as many compost piles as you can. I build one a day usually when I'm in a garden. So, maybe two cubic meters, which is, 6 feet for you guys?
Making a compost pile?
Okay, so the basis of compost is you've got your food scraps, so your everyday kitchen scraps, and your manure, and then your carbon, which is all your dry materials. So your leaf, your wood chip, sawdust, anything brown. Got me?
And it should all be chopped up as you go.
That should be reasonable size, because the bigger it is, the longer it's going to take to break down.
Oh.
Okay, so you've got, you know, you want stuff no bigger than that, really, ideally.
Okay.
So to start a compost, you want to pick a spot in the shade here, because you want it to be in the shade, because it gets hot in the pile. You don't want it to be in full sun, because there's no differentiation between the outside and inside temperature, because it's too hot here. So I found you've really got to try and put them in the shade so that they have some cooling, so it's just not hot, right? Because it helps them heat up more.
So maybe on the back side of the barn, or maybe we'll put lattices or a roof over some of our
compost. Should it be outside or inside? Does it matter? Like inside a barn, would you start one?
Do it inside a barn. But you can cover it just straight over the pile. You don't need to make special
shelter. Oh, you can cover it with...
With a tarp or something?
If you don't have a shady tree spot, you can put a cover over it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's fine. So you start off with some sticks, because when you're going straight on the ground, you want to create some kind of aeration and air pockets. So the first thing you just put down is some, like, branches with some diameter no bigger than that. Okay, and it just helps get some air in there, because there's a lot of weight and density happening as this pile gets big, right? So you want to keep some air that's close to the ground, because that helps the earth activate underneath. And then you'll put down, you can use green lawn clippings or leaves as your first basis, or even that stuff would be fine. And the key here is that you want to water the whole time. So while one person is piling the stuff on, the other person is watering.
Oh, really?
Sprinkling. Everything needs to be really well moistened in Arizona for it to work.
So wait, as you're building the layers up, you're watering it?
Watering the whole time, like you're watering a garden.
Wow.
And do you water it after you have your pile done?
You do that as well. But you just make sure, you'll be amazed how much water goes in, but you just water constantly. You don't stop watering when you're building.
And now, after it's built, do we water it?
Yeah.
How often?
I've found that the top sort of 6 inches of the pile is drying out if I don't water it, but the rest of the pile inside is fine. So you can leave that as a crust and not water if you don't want, especially if you don't have much water. And you can just leave it and let it compost. And that's the beauty of watering it really well when you build it. And you're just leaving a drier crust on the outside, which is sort of just protecting it. But if you really want the whole thing to break down and not have that crust that's getting dried out from because there's no humidity here, you want to water it every, you know, you could water it every couple of days, but give it a really good soak.
What size are you suggesting to start out with, like 10 foot by 10 foot? Or
you can go as big as you want. You can, yeah? You can do this as big as you want. There's no limitation.
Oh.
The only thing is, I usually build them about 6 by 6, no, not 6, about 4 feet by 4 feet because I can turn them myself.
Oh,
what do you mean turn them?
So once you've built your piles, it takes about a week for the microorganisms to kick in and for the pile to get really, really hot. And you'll see everything changes inside. And then to keep that process going, if you want to produce soil quickly, you turn it to speed it up.
Turn it over?
It gets hot. The pile gets really, really hot, and then it can slow down. But if you want to produce soil quickly, you'll turn it because that helps it break down.
Like, can't you turn it over with a shovel, you mean?
Pitchfork.
Oh, pitchfork?
Yeah.
Okay. That's cool. We have one of those.
Yeah, so you use a pitchfork to do that. So if we go back to the layering, okay, so the basis of compost is layering. So you put your sticks down and then some dry materials or green grass and food scraps and then manure. Okay, and every layer you're going to go for about this thick, all right, and even. And build it, and water every layer. So you just keep thinking food scraps, manure, carbon. Food scraps, manure, carbon. Okay, so I'm explaining building a big pile in one go right now, but what's more likely to happen with you guys here is you're going to add to it on a daily basis with your food scraps from the kitchen, right?
Right.
So every time you add food scraps to the pile, you're going to put manure onto that, water it, and then put your dry leaves on top of that. And you always finish with dry leaves. You never leave food scraps exposed or manure.
Oh, okay.
Ever.
Now, the manure that we have here, especially the cow manure, it's dry and it's hard. It's packed in. Should we break it up or just throw it in there hard like that?
You could throw it in or you could break it up. You know, it's all about efficiency of time. And if you wanted to get ideal about that, you could break it up, especially if it's really hard. You know, you could crush it up and moisten it down and have it sitting in a pile ready. Like do the process the whole lot and have it more padded and moisten it because it will be more activated and then add it to your – so it's ready to go when you put it in. Or you just break it up by hand when you put it in if you don't mind touching it.
Yeah.
Okay, now how long does – let's say we start a pile a day just for a number. Mm-hmm. And we start – day one, day two, day three, day four, we build it up. How long is it before pile one is ready to put into your garden area, and how do you put it? Do you rototill it in, or you just put it on the top?
Okay, so that really, really depends on how good you are at making compost. If you get really good, you can turn it around in 2 weeks.
Oh.
But most people can't do that. Because you have to really understand what's happening, and you have to get really perceptive with checking the pile and making them, you know, with really good intention about your layering and everything, because there's a chemistry to it. And it's totally possible to do that. You just need to water it really well, and you have to have really good even layers, and you have to be really vigilant about what you're putting in as far as food scraps go. If you put a bunch of citrus in, you're not going to get that happen because that will throw the balance out, will make it go acidic. So I'll give you a list of things that you can't put in the compost, which would affect it breaking down. And you know, otherwise you can go with building really hot compost that are fast. So you might be looking at, you know, 2 weeks at best and 2 months to end up with humus. Or you can go with slow compost where you just build them and you leave them for 6 months.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you just let them sit there.
Cool.
So it's up to you, and it depends what you've got going on. If you've got a whole bunch of resources turn up here and you just wanna make big piles and let them break down for 6 months, then you can do that. Or if you wanna like be really vigilant and have, you know, make a pile a day and 3 weeks later have that pile be finished and then the next day the next pile and you're like trucking soil into your garden, you know?
Well, you know, we have the Back Kins domain, which is nothing but flat desert. And then we have the section over there that you saw, which is nothing but flat desert. But eventually we're going to plant there. So in my head I'm thinking, why don't we start the piles there, mm-hmm. and then after we use them and put them in our gardens,
the soil will be better.
The soil will be way better, wouldn't it?
It'll be way better. And if that's exactly what I would do with that all that space you've got over there, I would start a composting campaign in your little town here and resource the other materials that you need from the horses and try and get hold of, you know, the carbon. That's going to be your challenge because there's just no trees out here. It's not like you have forestry or, you know. So you want to find a source of carbon and a lot of it, and you'll be able to do this.
Now, when you say carbon, that's not the horse manure.
That's
leaves.
Anything dry. So it's your dry leaves.
Palm fronds,
chopped
branches.
Up, clippings. I mean, everything dries out so quicker anyway, so it's ultimately going to end up like that pretty fast. But just all that kind of stuff, that's your carbon. You really need that.
How do you know when it's time to turn, did you say? When you
okay,
can turn the
compost? Say we put these guys in, right? You can see the colors and the shapes and all that stuff. When you do this layering system, it will heat up the next day. The next day it will be hot, and you're going to go in and you're going to check the pile and make sure it's heated up. You just put your hand right in there. Well, actually, don't do that on the second day because there will still be food scraps. But you just check it with a spade or something that it's heating up, and you're like, good. Now it's doing its thing. And a good compost, in about a week, you'll check it, and it'll still be hot, and what you'll notice is that there's no color. Everything's changed. You won't be able to recognize any food. There'll be no smell, and the color will be soil. But you'll still be able to recognize the carbon. You'll see wood chips and you'll see bits of manure and stuff, but you won't see any food scraps. Then you know your compost has worked really well. Because basically the pile has eaten up, you know, the enzymes in the fruits and the vegetables and used it, and that's what's created the heat.
Oh, okay.
That's the fuel that makes the compost go, right? Hmm. And that's the carbon and the nitrogen of the manure exchanging together makes fire as well. And the water is the oxygen. Okay, so that's it's like a fire. It's an earth fire instead of a, you know.
And at that point, you pitchfork it upside down. You flip it.
Okay, so then you can decide at that point if you're seeing no smell, no color, and you think, this is turning into soil. You can decide at that point to speed it up. And the way you would decide that, if it's really, really hot, I wouldn't disturb it.
Oh, yeah?
There's no need to. It's firing. Okay. It's like, just think of a fire. If a fire is burning well, you don't touch it. You just let it burn down, and then you add later, right?
Right.
The turn is like adding the log.
Oh, okay.
Right?
And in this particular case, water actually helps the fire.
Yeah, so when you turn it, you water it again.
Oh,
so okay. If you check it in a week or 2 weeks, and it's just like really petering out with its heat, but it's not broken down yet, you want to fire it up again.
Oh, okay.
So then you turn and water. And you might most often need to add some like fresh manure if it's slowed right down.
Really?
Yeah. And you can tell because the fruit will break down quick, and you know that that's working well if there's no smell.
Right.
And no colors. And that's pretty easy with this formula. But what you'll see, if it's getting cool too soon before the carbon breaks down, you'll see sticks and bark and pine cones and things like that. And you'll see soil, but you'll see these other large things still, and you go, okay, half of it's breaking down, but half of it's not. That's when you want to fire it up.
Turn it.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, to turn it and water it and let it go again.
Add another log to the fire. That's a good analogy.
Yeah.
A good way to remember it.
Yeah.
Okay, now let's say we start these in 3 months, 4 months goes, and we know it's all broken down to this beautiful stuff.
How to put it in.
Right.
Okay, so the best, so remembering that you want, so now what's going to happen at the end when you go to these piles, they're going to be full of microorganisms, bugs and little things running around, which is very different to when you buy soil in or here, right? There's nothing. It's just the base.
Where do they come from?
That's the miracle. The activity of the compost generates microorganisms, the things you can't see. And that sets off a whole chain of stuff, and bugs show up. Worms and bugs and everything just shows up. So now they're all living and they're doing the thing, and even the earthworms will turn up depending on where you are. Okay, so now you've got living soil that's like an ecology. The worst thing that you can do then is go and spread that out back under the sun.
Right.
You just kill it, right? So what I do is, if you're seed raising, you've got your seeds or your little plants or even your trees. Let's just talk about, say, you're putting some veggies in and planting out your veggie garden. You just need to take that much, one handful of that under every plant that you plant.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Under the plant.
So you've got your garden bed and you've got your little seedling to plant. You've got a little tray of lettuce or something to put in the ground. Mm-hmm. And you're going to put it in. You make a hole. You put your compost in, your humus, underneath the seedling. Plant that. Cover it up. And you're done.
Now, what about if we were doing a seed? A lettuce seed.
A seed? If you were doing seeds, you'd probably be prepping your bed a bit different. So you'd be prepping the soil, turning some of this humus through it, planting your seeds, and then mulching, so it's still not open and exposed.
So the key is not to have any exposed soil at all.
Mm-hmm.
Now, during the winter time here, two things struck me. One, we could probably put it in the underneath the trees because they got plenty of shade. And is that accurate? Can we put it in these areas?
It depends. It depends on what these trees are emitting. Some trees emit chemicals that inhibit anything else from growing. So you have to check, and especially these coniferous type trees. So there'll be things that will grow under here, but possibly growing veggies won't work.
No, I just want to put the soil in for the trees themselves to cover the soil.
Oh, the soil, fine, yeah.
Okay, so we can do that in the wintertime. Another interesting thing I thought about, in the wintertime, the wind blows this way, which is right where that field is, where we would put a lot of these compost piles. Do they emanate heat from them underneath the plastic?
They will, yeah. But don't use plastic.
Don't use plastic? What should we use to cover them?
You can use old blankets and all sorts of things.
What about tree branches? You showed me the one where you used the those wood things?
The pallets?
The pallets, is that?
Yeah, no, that was just for keeping the javelinas out. But basically your carbon layer is your protection. And in the winter you're not going to have to worry about the sun so much. You actually want the heat to get on them.
Okay.
In the winter.
Well, emit enough heat to come warm the area?
It could, if you did it on a big enough scale over there, for sure. That would work.
Okay, now we talked about something which is just a concept right now. As you know, we're 75 miles from Las Vegas. And we talked about taking, and I'm already doing this, I'm taking the clippings from Las Vegas every time I come out here and spreading around the trees. We talked about this concept you came up with taking all the organic matter from the Las Vegas hotels and bringing it out here and starting a whole sort of movement, because we certainly have the land here. Elaborate on how that would work.
Well, I mean, there's big composting models that you can check out in the world already, like citywide composting companies. So basically, they're doing what I just described on a massive scale with dozers and so forth. So it's just exactly the same formula. You can't cheat nature. You have to do that process. So, you'd have to not only have the food scraps, but you'd have to have a big supply of manure from cattle farms around here, plus the carbon, landscaping. So all the landscaping that happens in Las Vegas, mm-hmm. in the suburbs, you'd have to link up with all those kind of companies, and usually those guys pay to take the loads away from the garden and have to pay to drop it off somewhere. If you could defer that resource out here, then you've just got to make sure you've got those three. It's not enough just to have the food scraps, because you'll end up with a problem, right? You've got to have the three in equal.
Well, it seems easy. We have the horse rescue people with a lot of horses, so we can start a daily or twice a week manure run.
Mm-hmm.
I'm already bringing out, and I can increase that, the leaves and stuff from the gardeners, the landscapers, and then we just need the food scraps, and we got it made.
Yeah. Well, I would start it small and become compost experts, and get that wide and understand the technology and then grow it to scale. I mean, you're right. There's so much land out here and it's flat and there's no topsoil, so it would be perfect to utilize the resource of a big city nearby and do something good with all that wasted food. So there's definitely the space, and it's just be a matter of logistics, really.
It's a great, great recycling project we're going to start working on.
Yep.
Now, tell us what this is over here.
Okay, so I'm a big fan of biodynamics. So this is Peter's powder, biodynamic compost powder. And this is what you use when you're creating your compost. So you know how I said you're going to water it the whole time? You can add this to it. So sometimes I have someone watering and I have someone spraying and someone adding the compost material. So whilst the compost pile is getting watered, it's also getting sprayed with this biodynamic prep. Okay, so this is basically, I call it data. This is information. This has come from a pile that is what I'm talking about, made of really, really beautiful humus. Okay, so it's gone through that process. It's like homeopathics. It's like an inoculant. So they've taken the goodness from that pot, that pile, and it's encapsulated in a small amount that you can then dilute and put into your pile.
Quiet on the set. So,
does that make sense?
Yeah, so what I'm seeing here is that as we do our compost, the first one that's broken down, we can make this beautiful.
You always inoculate your next pile, well, if you've got it to that stage. You always inoculate the next pile with the humus.
That's cool.
Yeah, it's how do I describe it? It's like once you've got humus going on, everything's happening. Everything that the soil needs to know is contained. It's like information. It's like a file.
So it's almost like
you give it to the next, put it in the next file.
So it's like a fast start or a kick start.
Yeah, it's in like an inoculant. So this one you want to get this going. You want to make this into a paste. So you just add a little bit of water. Now, it's all about activation with biodynamics, and it's all about being very conscious with your intent. So there's a lot of information in here. I treat this stuff as really, really precious. It's like medicine. You think about fixing up a dose of medicine for someone in bed, like your child, and you want to make it, like, right, you know, because you want them to get better. That's what this is. So this is medicine for the soil. So you make that into a paste, and now you're going to let that sit for 12 hours in a warm spot. And it's going to activate. The water's going to activate that.
Now, in a warm spot, I mean, outdoors, like in the hot desert sun, or
no,
is that too hot?
Not in the light and not in the heat. Just somewhere warm. Anywhere it's warm here.
Just maybe underneath the
patio
or something.
Yeah.
Okay.
Out of the draft.
But out of the sun.
Yeah, not in the sun. And leave that for 12 hours and the water will activate. Okay, so now that's activated, so you got to leave it for a minimum of 12 hours. And then you're going to dilute it. And it actually doesn't matter how much you dilute it. It's homeopathic.
So you would take this much and put it maybe, could we put it in a tub that big?
More. You can put it in whatever amount of water. If you figure out how much water you would need to spray this whole farm, because you can use that for that as well, or to do one compost, because you've got to use it up in one go. You don't store it. So I would expect, do you guys say 44-gallon drums?
No, we don't have any drums. What about something as big as one of our water tanks over there?
No, because you need to use it straight away.
Okay.
So you need to figure out how much water you're going to use to build one compost pile.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And whatever that amount is, dilute that into it.
Okay, so we could probably use that tub, put it in there, mix it all up, and then put it on the compost piles as we're
I have a spray pack. So I have a you know, those pests people use them for pesticides and spray with a pump, pressure pump. So I put it on my back, or I have someone spray that onto the compost pile. So I might go through 6 or 7 of those backpacks whilst I'm building a compost pile.
Wow. So you because you're layering it. Every layer gets another water.
Yeah, you water it in the whole time as while you're watering it with normal water as well.
Okay. Now, would this work after the water, after we get the water? Does that water work as water for the plants, the trees as well? Or is it just for the compost?
You can use this one on both. Yeah.
And that'll feed the soil after we get, you know, all the stuff in here so it's not bare dirt.
Exactly. It tells the soil, it supports microorganism activity to happen.
So this is great. So
this is a mycelium activator.
And what is mycelium?
Well, I love mycelium. Mycelium is, it's like the internet of the natural world. So everything is connected through microorganisms under the soil. So when you build compost, you're actually activating mycelium to grow again. And mycelium is basically the information network between all the plants, just like in Avatar when they talk about Awa. So, and mushrooms are what you see as like the fruit of that network. Mushrooms are the flowers of the mycelium network.
So there's actually a network, a microorganism network in the soil all over the earth?
Absolutely.
And they're all connected like the internet?
Everything's connected.
Well,
that's why we're all one.
And so this is a scientific validity to that connection that we're totally, mostly in this world, unaware of.
Totally. Well, it's totally available scientifically that's there. There just hasn't been enough value on that. How that dynamic and that connection between everything is really, really important. So that, you know, just stripping the topsoil away like they've done for decades and selling it off and shipping it out has been stripping the top levels of the earth of its mycelium, right? And all of a sudden you have these massive forests die. It's all of a sudden gone because there's no network there anymore.
Wow. Now, Bella, tell us a little bit about your social network that you run and how people can find you and find the it's right there on the right below us. And talk about that a little bit.
Well, I started that social network when I read the Ringing Cedars books back in 2008, and I was so enchanted by the story of Anastasia, and I resonated with her so much that I really decided to put my weight behind those books, and I haven't really done that for anything else except for sustainability and permaculture in my whole career. And I could see some ancient wisdom in there that really filled in some big holes in why eco-villages fail, why we're all in this, you know, ignorance, why people are unhealthy. There was just so much in those books that was just spot on. It made so much good sense that I went, right, here's a lot of missing pieces here to the work that I'd done before. And so I built the social network to help people see that other people were also working on it, and with a special flavor of being like not just doing permaculture but being really, really sacred about our relationship with the earth and understanding more what native people understood in their daily lives, that every day is a celebration and every day ritual is just so enhancing to life, and celebrating your connection with the earth and your connection to spirit. And that every day is sacred because we've gotten so far away from that. And I see Anastasia as an Indigenous white person. And I'd studied Indigenous people all over the world before I read those books, and was so, you know, I felt so much resonance with that. But I grew up in a Western culture, and I was like, well, where do I fit in? And so when I read those books, I was like, oh, okay, we've just our indigeneity, as we say, is so far back as white people we've forgotten. I think the Sami people up in the top of Norway are an indigenous white people that still live in a traditional way on the planet. But they're so rare that we just don't associate ourselves as being native. And I really value living like that and living close to nature and all the things that Anastasia talks about. So I just decided that, look, this is really, really valuable information. So I made that social network. But since then, I have seen the need to merge some movements together on the planet to really help people not get caught up in thinking something's a cult and having, you know, avoiding good information just because it appears the wrong way. And permaculture is something that's universal, and biodynamics is very universal, even though people think that's a bit woo-woo too. But all this stuff, it's just basic common sense when you get into it. It's just that it's more sacred, and it's really taking attention to the dynamic relationship between things, which often when you witness them are very, very miraculous. And so then they have this sacred quality or miracle quality to them. But it's just that that's what life is. It's very, very miraculous. It's miraculous to be alive. So there's nothing woo-woo about life. It's just really quite beautiful. It's just that life, as we know it, has become very mundane.
Now, you went out to the 500 acres where we plan to build It's Golden Ranch Kin's Community, and you toured that, and you toured the 4,000 acres with us. And we're going to put together in March of next year a course out there on the land. We're also going to set up tours, which will be Eco Harmony Tours, with a friend of yours, Jim from Sedona. And you can see that video next about what we plan to do there. So tell us about these 2 to 4 week courses that we're going to have on the property out there, because we are selling lots as of now and parcels of land for the 500 acres for people that want to build a Kin's Community, but we just don't want people to come and buy the land. The study on eco villages is a study on failure. So elaborate a little bit of that and why the courses, and how do they get in touch with you to get information on how to take these courses if they want to be a part of that community out there.
Okay, well, yeah, this has been my work for a long time, and so I've seen a lot of challenges come up for people, you know, starting eco villages or trying to commune with each other. And, you know, we know how to garden, we know how to make soil, and if you do enough research, you can find that stuff out, right? And just basically get on the net now and look up world's best compost practice, and you could hopefully find what I've just told you. But humans relating to each other is a whole different thing, and so, you know, we have this sort of desire and vision that's coming from a lot of people to get back to the land, to get back to nature, to have more neighborly relationships, to support each other, to be off grid. And being off grid means one thing. You're taking your dependency off one system, and means you actually need to be able to depend on each other. And so successful eco-villages in the world have evolved or developed strong social ecology, and that means, you know, changing the way sort of manufactured lives, and we do our job every day, and we hopefully have nice people in our lives and say hi, but there's a lot of craziness that goes on, and you can't have that stuff going on when you're out off grid, you know, because your lives are at risk. Basically, you've got to be able to support yourself energetically with food and water and solar and all these things, and things do go wrong. You've got to realize, if you want to live in an off-grid eco-village, that it takes a whole different set of skills than it does to live in the city. So a lot of the time I see people getting really excited about, but not really sitting down and thinking, what does that really mean? What's it going to really take for me to live like that? So then what happens is you haven't thought about that and gone through that process, and then you just bring your city habits out and then try and expect the people around you to have to deal with that. And a lot of problems come up for people. So, does that make sense?
Yeah, I can see that being a problem for sure.
And so I lived in a commune for quite a while and, put a lot of money into it and a lot of hard work to build a house, and thought that I would have that little sanctuary for the rest of my life. And it all went belly up. And I realized why, because I never take things personally, was because you had a bunch of Western people trying to live in a tribe together, and we're not wired for it. We don't have the memory and the experience of how to actually cooperate really well. So the beauty of the kinsdomain concept is that you do have your own sovereign space. You have complete capacity to design and create and be in full control of your own little bit of earth, but you still want to be with good neighbors, right? So the process of developing a kin's domain for us through biospiritual permaculture is actually much more in depth than just selling land off and hoping for the best. It's actually a process of applying and expressing your interest in this development because you'd really like to live somewhere like Gold Mountain Ranch. And then we have, through a process of self-inquiry, can really look into your story and where you've been in life and what your experiences are and what your gift is and what your edges are and what might really frustrate you, and really take responsibility for who you are, because then you know what you're bringing to the community. And we want to develop communities where everybody's gifts are really, really valued, and everybody's wounds from being disconnected or not having enough family around or going through hard times with money or whatever those things are also acknowledged, but in a really functional, healing way, not in a dysfunctional, destructive way, because there's no point us trying to build new ways of living if they perpetuate destruction and pain for people. We want them to be places of healing in many ways, in connecting with the earth and connecting with each other. And so we've spent a lot of time researching social ecology and experiencing different things so that we can set up a process and a program to help people get through that passage. And it doesn't mean anyone needs to be perfect or have this specific set of qualities. It's just to create a space where it's really functional. It's like a good business or a machine that works well. You know?
How do you do that? Do you screen the people that come in, or you just help them when they have problems with therapy, or what?
So yeah, there's a filtering process, because this is an extreme environment, as an example. This is a desert environment, so we need to make sure that people really understand what that would require. People get excited about Eco Village and think, oh, okay, this could be a really affordable dream for me. I'll go live in the desert. But they need to be teamed up with someone who's lived in the desert for a long time. So it's both things. It's what you asked. It's a combination of filtering and helping people establish whether this is really for them, rather than just going, great, we want to sell you some land. It's to help people go, right, is this going to really work for you or your family? And then also giving them opportunities through the tours and the courses to come and have a taste.
Oh, okay.
Right? Yeah. So you come out and live in tribe for 2 weeks, live on the land, get a taste for the environment, have a really good understanding of what is involved with setting up your kin's domain out here, and then you're going to have a really, really good idea. And not only that, you're going to learn stuff regardless, you know, whether you stay or not.
Right.
You'll learn stuff that will help you go off and put you in really good stead to do it somewhere else. So it's an active, what we call active learning and experiential. So everything's hands-on. There's no teaching anybody anything. It's just like, we're here building this eco village, and this is what we need to do, and this is the culture that we're creating to get those things done, and come and join in, and you can see whether you like it. And then from that, you work out whether you fit together. It's like when animals meet, you know, it's like sniffing each other out and...
Good analogy, yeah.
Checking each other out and finding out whether or not it's a match, you know, and sometimes it doesn't work, and that's okay. There's no hard feelings. It's just like being really, really vigilant about not assuming things. We assume things too much in a superficial reality where, oh, yeah, that's a great idea. It's not enough to have a good idea when you're trying to set up a life.
Yeah, right.
It takes hard work. It takes
commitment
to yourself, the earth, and to other people. Because you need to rely on each other. If you're in a community and you say you're going to do something, you've got to show up for that. So we want to help make sure that, especially for the property owners that we're helping, we want to make sure that we're helping them find really good people that can help develop that community together. And vice versa. We're making sure that the people who might join the Eco Village are getting what the property owners are saying that they're going to offer,
right,
stuff like
right.
that. We just do all that background stuff as well.
So this is actually a demonstration of what's known as triple bottom line accounting, because this is a company, and it'll be a public company, that owns that 500 acres, and people will actually be able to buy stock in the marketplace, and that we don't know what the stock symbol will be yet. But, and the triple bottom line says people, planet, profits. And in our case, it's in that order. People, planet, profits. We're not developing Ken's community at Gold Mountain Ranch to just sell off a bunch of land to people and make a profit and run away with it. We want to create a successful community. We want to create a flourishing community. The Ken's Domain concept and the stuff that you learn in the Ringing Cedars of Russia series of books really make that very, very different than anything else. And it's a huge experiment and movement worldwide. So, I mean, it just does seem like, to me, triple bottom line from, you know, the business part of it. And I love that kind of stuff. So when and also, if they decide they don't want a desert community, you know, the desert, it's too hot. You know, even though we are about 8 degrees cooler than Las Vegas, and I loved our location because anyone from anywhere in the world can fly into Las Vegas. Everyone loves to do that, and it's very inexpensive. And then we're 500 acres is about 85 miles away from Las Vegas. And so they can get a taste of these courses. But let's say they don't want a desert. You're doing these courses in other locations around the world?
We are. We're doing a long course in Costa Rica in February next year. It'll be like 4 weeks. That's in the jungle with a waterfall, and that's it. We start with a bare block of land, and we have our people come in, and each year we'll come back there and we'll keep upgrading it, and we're helping the Costa Rican family that we're doing this with to create a sustainable campground that they can run for the rest of the year then that we're not there. But the idea of that is that if you can come and have a tribe experience in that really raw environment like that, you'll find it pretty easy to go back to your city and help get community going there, because, you know, your buttons really get pushed when you're that exposed in nature, and there's not all the comforts, and, you know, there's no electricity. There's not going to be even any shelter at that one.
Wow.
So,
it's rough, isn't it?
Yeah, it's getting, but it's beautiful. It's not the rainy season. It's perfect temperature all the time. It's really comfortable. Oh. I went down there and scoped it all out and made sure that it was possible to do this, and it is, because you don't have to worry about the rain. It's just not going to rain, and there's no mosquitoes, you know, and it's just it's not as scary as you think about, you know, the jungle and the tropics. But
it's a 4 week expedition.
It's 4 weeks of getting really in touch with your inner self and in touch with nature, so that you can really find your inner gift, you know, and get reconnected. And then,
that's cool.
Yeah, and develop those skills of tribe and creating things together, so that it's going to be fantastic. And then we will have another one up in a 2 week course up in Northern California that will probably be late January, actually, at our Occupy the Mansion project up near Napa, and also we'll be doing a 2 week course in Italy in April.
Wow. So this is it may be instrumental for people to go to all the courses almost, or at least more than just one.
You can keep diving in, you know, because every course will be at a different climate, so you'll learn different things about permaculture in different climates, and obviously different people each time. So you're going to get different interactions and learn different things from each other, because it's this thing of participatory design and social ecology. So everyone brings something to each event. We set it up so that there's a definite intention for what's going to be experienced, but everyone's a character in the movie, you know?
Now, and where do you find this information on where these courses are going to be?
This is all available on biospiritualpermaculture.com. And the network, the global forum that we have, that's loaded up with content, which gives you more insight into this whole thinking and philosophy and the projects that we've got going, is biospiritualpermaculture.net. But go to biospiritualpermaculture.com and you'll find the links there.
Awesome. Well, Billa, thank you so much for being here, and thank you so much for launching KINS 201, which is the more advanced you know, gardening technologies, permaculture, biodynamic planting, and all that stuff. You are, you know, the experts on it. I'm the city slicker that is doing this. I used to grow organic gardens when I was a kid, but, you know, that was too long ago. and we want to, again, thank you for being here, and it's just
You're
an
welcome.
Absolute pleasure having you here.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
Thank you for being here at KINS 201.